In Peru, rural workers continue to protest for their labor rights. France had relaxed its ban on trucks arriving from the UK, with drivers crossing the English Channel required to provide a negative coronavirus test. Many healthcare workers in Kenya continue a nationwide strike against the lack of personnel and resources amid the COVID-19 pandemic. From the headquarters of teleSUR English in Havana, Cuba, this is From the South. I'm Gladys Quesada. In Peru, farm workers continue to take to the streets to demand the repeal of the agrarian promotion law and have called a national strike for December 29th. Farm workers maintain blockades in various sections along the Southern Pan-American Highway in the midst of police deployment. This happens after the Congress failed to approve the substitute text that proposed a new agrarian labor regime. The demonstrators have been demanding better wages and respect for their rights as producers. Several spokespersons of the farmer movement have expressed that the sector is one of the most precarious in the country because the previous law of agrarian promotion only favors the agro-export entrepreneurs to the detriment of the interests of the rural workers. Bolivia's Vice Minister of Epidemiological Promotion, Maria René Castro, confirmed that the nation prepares to get 6.5 million doses of COVID-19 vaccine in the first month of 2021. The World Health Organization will provide 20% of the doses needed to immunize the entire population through its COVAX program, while the Bolivian executive, by express order of President Luis Arce, will procure the remaining. The initial 6.5 million doses will be destined to risk groups, people over 60, and health sector personnel, while the remaining percentage of doses will be administered to the population over 18. The vice minister also reiterated that the vaccine will be free of charge throughout the country. And Colombia's President Iván Duque said its administration will refuse to provide coronavirus vaccines to hundreds of thousands of Venezuelan refugees within its borders, in a move which stunned public health experts and prompted condemnation from humanitarian groups. Speaking to a local radio station on Monday, Duque said that only Venezuelans with a dual nationality or formal migratory status will have access to the vaccine when it's eventually distributed in the country. He also said that the controversial decision was taken to prioritize Colombians and to prevent a rush on the border. Venezuela has its own vaccination plan and has started a program to produce the Russian vaccine Sputnik V in national facilities. Meanwhile, Colombia faces a resurgent coronavirus outbreak, with cases climbing by over 10,000 a day following months of respite. Lockdowns and other restrictions over the Christmas period have been put in place by local mayors. Russia and Colombia face diplomatic discord after the government of Colombia confirmed this Tuesday the expulsion of two Russian diplomats who allegedly were carrying out spying work in the South American nation, and in response, Russia decreed as persona non grata the two Colombian diplomats on their national territory. The Russian diplomats identified as Alexander Nikolayevich and Alexander Paristov, attached to the Russian Military Intelligence Service and the Foreign Intelligence Service, had been expelled on December the 8th. According to the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Claudia Blum, the alleged spies had structured a highly organized plan. As a response for these actions, the Russian Ministry of Foreign Affairs informed through its website that it declared as persona non grata two employees of the diplomatic representation of Colombia in Moscow. According to a statement on December 22nd, Colombia's ambassador to the Russian Federation, Alfonso López Caballero, was summoned to the Foreign Ministry to protest the Colombian side's unfounded decision to expel two diplomats from the Russian diplomatic representation in Bogotá. In Argentina, several relatives of the victims of the dictatorship of 1976 to 1983, as well as the prosecutors, witnesses, and inquisitive judges driving the cause of the so-called death flights, judges conducted an ocular inspection of the planes used by the dictatorship's terrorism forces. The death flights were a method of extermination consisting on throwing people into the sea from an airplane, used by the terrorist dictatorship that ruled Argentina in order to kill the missing detainees and eliminate the evidence of the crime. The Federal Oral Court II of San Martin issued an injunction to preserve evidence that could be found in UNUSC aircraft, currently abandoned in the Army Battalion 661, and that could have elements useful to the case. The court, which will hold its penultimate hearing of the year next Monday, awaits justice for the more than 1,000 victims who disappeared in the flights of death. A scientific research group identified a new strain of COVID-19 in the Brazilian state of Rio de Janeiro, one of the most affected regions by the pandemic. The research was presented by the National Laboratory of Scientific Computing, linked to the Ministry of Science and Technology, and carried out jointly with the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. The studies confirmed that the new strain was discovered last October and is so far partially controlled. The city of Rio registers the highest number of COVID-19 infections and fatalities. Scientists have so far discovered 5 mutations of the virus after the study of 180 COVID genomes. However, they cannot point out if this new mutation will be more aggressive or could reduce the effectiveness of the vaccines that are starting to be distributed. An Afro-Brazilian councilman denounced the increase of threats by racist groups in the city of Curitiba, in the state of Paraná. Let's watch this story.
The conservative state in southern Brazil that is best known as the headquarters of the now disgraced Operation Car Wash has been the site of some of the nation's most important labor conflicts in recent years.
The state of Paraná is a laboratory for all of Bolsonaro's evil. Now they are laying off over 9,000 public school workers and substituting them, people outsourced to the private sector. It is a radically neoliberal policy that is destroying public education.
Paraná Governor Ratinho Jr., the son of a neo-fascist television personality and close ally of far-right President Jair Bolsonaro, has been using the COVID-19 pandemic as a smokescreen to push through deep austerity cuts. But the teachers' union is fighting back.
Our governor has taken advantage of the pandemic to eliminate labor rights. So we are fighting to reverse this, but above all, we are fighting to increase appreciation for knowledge, science, ethics, and the truth, and to recuperate the importance of school in Brazilian society.
2021 promises to be a year of more strikes and more protests in Paraná. Brian Mir, teleSUR, Curitiba.
And we have more stories coming up after this final short break, so stay with us.
Who's moving the chess man? What interests and motivate the actors behind each event? What's at stake? Critical Moves investigates every event from Monday to Friday. Only on teleSUR.
Welcome back to From the South. Britain's Transport Secretary late Tuesday said France has relaxed its ban on trucks arriving from the UK, with drivers crossing the English Channel required to provide a negative coronavirus test.
with the French government, and what with tests for everybody leaving the country, that means that you must have had a test within the last 3 days, and of course it's got to be a test which is certified as well. It's going to enable French citizens primarily to return, because basically, unfortunately, Brits have to stay home this Christmas, and we'll be saying more about hauliers who for the moment must stay put. They mustn't travel to Kent at this moment in time. So in fact, after some very good discussions today, the French are accepting lateral flow tests, which means that, as some viewers will know, they're quick and easy to do. They bring a very fast result by comparison. And so the French will be accepting lateral flow tests that will help to speed things up and enable the clearance of what's really quite a significant backlog for the border for hauliers and enable people to return home.
France relaxed its coronavirus-related ban on trucks from Britain on Tuesday after a two-day standoff that has stranded thousands of drivers and raised fears of Christmas-time food shortages in the UK. After 2 days of intense talks with British and European Union partners, French Transport Minister Jean-Baptiste Djebbari said in a statement that the coming hours will be dedicated to setting up testing sites so that British truckers could make it to the continent and back in time for Christmas. At least 2,800 truck drivers had been anxiously waiting near the England Channel, the port of Dover, for word they could cross over the continent. And freight from Britain and passengers with a negative virus test began arriving on French shores Wednesday, after France relaxed a two-day blockade over a new virus variant that had isolated the UK, stranded thousands of truck drivers and raised fears of food shortages. People arriving from Britain are required to have a virus test capable of detecting the new variant, according to a late-night agreement reached after 48 hours of frenzied negotiations among French, British and EU authorities. European nations and others around the world began closing their borders to Britain on Sunday, a day after the UK Prime Minister announced that the new variant was mostly responsible for a surge in new infections in London and southern England, imposing tight new lockdown restrictions. UK officials began setting up a temporary coronavirus testing centre at a lobby park on the former Milestone Airport site near the port of Dover on Wednesday in an attempt to clear queues of lorries prevented from entering France. Around 4,000 lorries and hundreds of more vans are parked at the Milestone site, where some drivers have been waiting for days to travel across the Channel into Euro-British communities. Secretary Robert Jenrick advised drivers not to head the southeastern county of Kent, where the Dover crossing is located, until the backlog is cleared, and warned that it could take days to test all the drivers before they can travel to France. And a huge fire broke out Wednesday at a migrant camp in northwestern Bosnia, which has been the focus of human rights groups due to poor conditions in the camp. Thick black smoke has been rising from parts of the Lipa camp near the Croatian border, with currently houses some 1,200 migrants. The cause of the fire has not been identified and no injuries have been reported. Bosnia has become a bottleneck for thousands of migrants hoping to reach the European Union. Most of them are concentrated in the northwestern Krajina region, as other regions in the country refuse to accept them. Many migrants have also alleged violence at the hands of Croatia's police. French authorities said a gunman who had beaten and threatened his wife in southern France killed three policemen who came to the woman's aid and then fled, prompting a wide manhunt. The killing of three police officers on duty drew national concern Wednesday, notably from French leaders who are under pressure from police to do more to protect them. A spokesperson from the gendarme service said the woman called for police help after threats from her husband at their home in a mountainous area in the village of Saint-Just. The spokesperson also said that after a lengthy standoff, three police officers were killed and another injured, and the gunman fled. Some 300 police were sent to the area to search for the gunman, and he was found dead in circumstances that remain unclear. The woman was taken into police care. France's Interior Ministry reported that 146 women were killed by their partners last year, which prompted a nationwide campaign against domestic violence. And we have more stories coming up after this final short break, so stay with us.
Para mantenerme saludable, yo corro.
To keep myself healthy, I study.
Για να διατηρηθώ υγιής, τρέφομαι σωστά.
Para mantenerme saludable, yo bailo.
Para mantenerme saludable, yo purifico mi espíritu a través del cuerpo. ¿Y tú?
Guide your body. Choose this. Only on teleSUR.
teleSUR invites you this week to enjoy interviews with specialists and doctors by our journalist Aisa Garcia. Wednesday to Friday. Only on teleSUR.
Innovation, science, the technological breakthrough and its influence in society.
Viajeros del saber, el futuro está aquí.
Adamant. Monday, only on teleSUR.
Welcome back from the South. Many healthcare workers in Kenya continued a nationwide strike on Wednesday to protest the lack of personal protective equipment and health insurance for frontline workers fighting against the spread of the coronavirus. Nurses, doctors, and clinical officers have stopped working across the country on Monday over concerns of what they call negligence by the government. In Kenya, more than 30 doctors, 29 nurses, and 10 clinical officers have died from the virus during the pandemic. More than 2,000 other healthcare workers have also contracted the virus. The Kenyan National Union of Nurses has urged all of its 23,000 members to stay away from their workstations until their grievances are met and addressed by the government. To this date, Kenya registers more than 94,000 COVID-19 cases and over 1,600 fatalities.
The biggest fear is continue losing lives. Because number one, the environment that we are in is not favorable. We don't have a comprehensive medical cover. If I was to fall a victim today, the best place I could go is to a private institution whereby I will end up footing the bills. Suppose I die, I have a young family. Who is going to take care of that family? Then the government is not going to chip in.
The Israeli Knesset spokesperson office confirmed early Wednesday that the country is heading to its fourth elections in 2 years. A deadline for parliament to pass a new budget passed at midnight, forcing the Knesset to dissolve and automatically triggering new elections on March 23rd. The failure to reach a budget brings about the collapse of Israel's current government. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and his main rival Benny Gantz formed their coalition in May to take on the challenges of the coronavirus crisis, but their partnership has been plagued by mistrust and infighting. And thousands of people took to the streets of Yerevan demanding the Armenian Prime Minister's resignation over his handling of the Nagorno-Karabakh conflict with Azerbaijan. Opposition politicians and their supporters have been calling for Prime Minister Nikol Pashinyan to step down for weeks since he signed a peace deal that halted 44 days of deadly fighting at the cost of territorial concessions to Azerbaijan. Crowds of protesters gathered near government buildings in Yerevan, chanting, "Nikol, go away." Several hours into the rally, opposition supporters erected tents of Yerevan's main square. The prime minister defended the deal as a painful but necessary move that prevented Azerbaijan from overrunning the entire Nagorno-Karabakh region. And the U.S. President Trump has urged Congress to amend a $900 billion coronavirus relief bill to more than triple its stimulus payments to Americans. In a video message posted on his Twitter, he said the package really is a disgrace, full of wasteful items. It's called the COVID relief, but it has almost nothing to do with COVID, he said. His statement stunned Capitol Hill. Republicans and Democrats have been negotiating a coronavirus stimulus rescue package since July, and Mr. Trump, who has largely stayed out of the talks, has been expected to sign the legislation into law following its passage through Congress on Monday night. The package of measures is linked to a bigger government spending bill, which includes foreign aid funding as well as $1.4 trillion spending measure to fund federal agencies for the next 9 months. Those agencies will have to shut if the president vetoes or refuses to sign it by midnight next Monday. The relief package contains a number of provisions that will help tens of millions of Americans struggling to make ends to meet in the pandemic-battered economy. And we have come to the end of this news brief. But remember, you can find this and many other stories on our website at telesurenglish.net. And also, if you feel so inclined, please follow us on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Telegram. For Telesur English, I'm Gladys Quesada. Thank you for watching.